introduction. So I'm Christopher Ricks. I'm one of the first year residents. I'm going to talk about atrophy of the visual pathway in glaucoma. So the question I want to address is, how extensive is the neurological damage from glaucoma? Is it end of the optic nerve with a large cup to disc ratio, and or does it go farther back, and how far back? So start with a case, 87-year-old woman, referred for both retina and glaucoma. Past medical history of glaucoma, hypertension, diabetes, hyperlipidemia, AFib, as well as a few other things. Her past ocular history, so her glaucoma has been very well treated. Diagnosed back in the 1980s with pseudoexfoliation glaucoma. She had phaco trab in the right eye, SLT in the left eye, in 2013. There may have been more things that happened in between there and when the Epic records started kicking in. We had a trab done in the left eye, 2014, SLT in the right eye, blood revision in the right eye, a lot of different drop regimens over the 30 plus years she'd been treated for glaucoma. And in April 2016, it was felt that her visual acuity and her visual fields were stable. Vision was 20 over 30 and 20 over 20, and IOP was well controlled. Then in December, she started feeling like her vision was worsening, so she was referred to both retina and neuro-ophthalmology. So you can see her visual fields from 2013 when we first had access to the digital version, and then in 2016. Some minor changes, specifically the left eye and the superior nasal field, and then centrally in the right eye. So she was seen in retina in April 2017, and it was felt that she had macular degeneration, very, very mild, not enough to explain the changes. And they agreed with the neuro-ophthalmology referral. You can see her OCT of her macula, just generalized thinning of the entire macula. So then in May, she was seen in the neuro-ophthalmology clinic. Chief complaint was that her vision was worse. She would say, kind of her self-visual acuity check, which she'd walk out every morning and she'd see the mountains from her front porch, and like the tops were sort of blurry, and that was kind of the main thing she had noticed. So visual acuity had dropped to 20/50 and 20/30. IOP was still well controlled, no APD. Color vision was not good at all. And then stereo vision was poor. Anterior segment was relatively normal. She had cataract surgery. Posterior segment, she had quite a bit of cupping in her optic nerves and then some RPE changes throughout the retina. You can see the visual field that was done, progression of that superior nasal field, and then that central area in the right eye. An OCT of the RNFL was done that showed generalized thinning, as we'd expect. And being the neuro-ophthalmology service, like we said, we took a look at the MRIs, because we always do. And we noticed that her chiasm was very, very small compared to a normal patient's optic chiasm. You can see quite a bit of thinning there. The axial view, you can see the optic tract, very, very thin and attenuated versus the normal optic tract is quite a bit more robust than in the normal control patient. So our impression was that she had atrophy of the visual pathway secondary to her chronic glaucoma. We recommended continuing to treat the glaucoma and then also managing her vascular risk factors. Remember, she had all of them, essentially. So what does the literature say about this? In a paper by Kashiwagi et al. In Journal of Glaucoma 2004, they did a study on 31 patients with advanced glaucoma, 26 healthy controls, age and gender matched. And their conclusion was that MRI of the anterior visual pathway may be a good tool for evaluating glaucomatous damage objectively. Specifically, they measured smaller optic nerves in glaucoma patients. The height of the optic chiasm was thinner in glaucoma patients. Although they did say in their study that the height of the optic chiasm had a low correlation with the cup to disc ratio. In the British Journal of Radiology, a study by Kitsos et al., of 26 patients with advanced glaucoma, 26 controls, their conclusions were that POAG leads to optic nerve atrophy and degeneration of the entire optic pathway. The finding of increased numbers of white matter hyperintensities in the brain of patients with POAG suggests that hypoperfusion due to microangiopathy may play a role. Basically suggesting that, you know, maybe there's other things besides just increased, you know, the eye findings attributing to this atrophy of the entire pathway, including the optic nerve. So they found optic nerve atrophy, degeneration of the chiasm, and they even found degeneration of the occipital cortex, white matter, and then all the microvascular changes. In a study done by Zhang et al., They found that patients with normal pressure glaucoma have an age-adjusted reduced optic nerve diameter, optic chiasm height, and LGN volume as measured by MRI, and this correlates with a reduced RNFL thickness. So you can see a graph here of some of their data showing 15 millimeters behind the optic nerve, there's a great correlation between the RNFL thickness. And then different measurements, 5, 10, and 15 millimeters behind the eye, there's quite a bit of difference in the optic nerve diameter. They suggested even that MRI may be applied to examine the optic nerve in patients with glaucoma with opaque optic media, suggesting that it's another way to monitor their glaucoma. And the way it all suggested that they saw widespread CNS abnormalities through based on the diffusion tensor imaging. Basically, all these studies are coming to the same conclusion. There's damage throughout the whole entire system of the optic, the visual system. So a few questions that I want to address since we have quite a few experts in the room. First one is, what role does glaucoma play in atrophy of the visual pathway behind the optic nerve? I'd be curious to hear some of your thoughts. I know Dr. Roscoe often talks about how glaucoma is felt to be a vascular disease in some patients.
I mean, I think your level of damage will be proportional to the amount of, the ganglion cell goes from lateral into the body to the retina. So I mean, I think you're going to have atrophy all along the way. Beyond that, I wouldn't know. But I mean, I think it's going to be proportional amount of loss throughout the system.
So we've always kind of had this theory that in the nervous system, that if the disease is in cell system X, that everything else kind of stays there. I call it the light cycle theory of vision. The bolt is gone and everything else is ready. You just screw the bolt back in, everything is fine. And frankly, the core work that's been done on this that is internationally recognized is our own Robert Mark and Brian Jones, who sat there and shown, no, the retina just doesn't sit there. If you knock half off rods and cones, the retina just say, okay, all right, we're ready for some rods and cones. It generates extensively, and it continues to do so. It works itself into an atrophic, self-stimulating series of cycles. And the early work now done shows that continues on through the process, through the visual process, that the nervous system likes to be stimulated. And a part of an example of that is why patients with macular degeneration get these form of hallucinations. Those are self-stimulatory type processes that are ongoing. And that's part of the whole system. So I think, again, it's amazing how that still is out there. I mean, there are still people pushing the retinitis pigmentosa that the retina is otherwise just sitting ready to be wired out. And yeah, you can get percepts. Stimulate with enough energy to get something, but you don't just have the system sitting there ready to go. And that work now is for those who understand core physiology is now well accepted. When it was first proposed by Robert Mark, it was roundly excoriated as being a horrible thought and not possible and the rest. And I remember Gene Nguyen, when that was first presented, I was sitting next to him and he just said, well, I find that very offensive. It either is or isn't, and so we got to be careful about how we get involved. So I don't see this as any problem. Here's my thought in regards to this work about the fact that MR scan is a good way to to tell in regards to glaucoma. It's about the same as saying death correlates very well with being ill. If you need an MR scan to know you got glaucoma, you've been missing some really serious things for a long time. So, is there enough damage done? If you're knocking off the ganglion cells, you can probably see atrophy. No, we're not sure. I mean, that shouldn't surprise anybody. If you're knocking off the entire stimulatory pathway from the eye, is that going to result in changes? I think from Brian, from Robert Mark and Brandwood, the answer to that is yes. That the visual pathway itself is going to be impacted. And so I don't. I think it's a kind of what would you expect more than, well, this is a head scratcher. And it's amazing how continuing people don't realize how the nervous system responds in a very aberrant way if it's not getting the stimulation that it expects.
where if glucose is out of whack for a long time, that even when you get it in back into control, that there is damage done that doesn't seem to be able to be reversed, and that we're better off treating early. So it would be interesting to know what happens in that, if there is an ability to sort of reverse some of the damage that we see.
Just kind of like Randy's point, just kind of refer to this about the MRI scan and glaucoma condition. I could say typical situations, the nerves don't look quite like glaucoma, they're not cut to things, but in a case like this, it's pretty straightforward. It's a $2,000 MRI scan with the reason it was obtained in this patient.
If I remember right, she'd had a fall, I think, and so it wasn't done for this. We just happened to have access to it.
Sorry, and this is the very beginning of your case, but this has become a not terribly uncommon neuro-ophthalmology consult request that somebody gets a scan for some other reason, and the radiologist says, this person looks like they might have high intraocular pressure, or this person has dilated nerve sheath, or the optic nerves are asymmetric. And so the person who ordered the scan gets that report, and it causes somewhat of a hullabaloo. And then sort of nobody kind of puts all the pieces together and says, well, you know, the, you know, could somebody just sort of think about how this might actually just be the case? Yes, they had a traumatic optic neuropathy 30 years ago, and their right optic nerve is atrophic. And thank you very much, radiologist, for letting us know, but we kind of knew about that. Thanks a lot. It's like when the radiologist calls to tell me that somebody's got papilledema, edema, and I sort of say, thank you, that's very helpful. That's kind of why I ordered the scan, but yes, that's, thank you very much. I'm glad you could see that. But, you know, there's been this intersection of radiology has improved phenomenally in the last 10 years, and they can actually see this now. I mean, you wouldn't have gotten any calls like this 10 years ago because they wouldn't have been able to see that subtle finding. And so now it's just something that we're having to kind of understand as a almost like a technological advance. This is not, obviously, how you diagnose glaucoma at all, because it's completely nonspecific. Every optic atrophy will cause the optic nerves to look small. But in case
and
you
it's
were,
an advanced finding. I mean, this is something that happens after one
and,
major
and,
bad.
And answer to Emmy's question, you know, by the time the optic nerves are looking small in the MRI scan, I don't think that anybody in the glaucoma world at current treatment capacity feels like that's anything even close to reversible. What you would hope is perhaps that you could stop it from getting worse.
Yeah, but the key there is current.
Right.
Because there's a lot of research in this area, and I think there's hope for the future.
I don't think anybody's got any good optic nerve regeneration stuff yet, but boy, that would be nice.
So the follow-up for question is, what about from the other direction? Does a lot of microvascular disease and cortical atrophy play a role in what we're calling just pure glaucoma? Any specific thoughts on that? I think we definitely will see atrophy of the whole visual pathway. Is that going to correlate with what we consider glaucomatous changes, a retrograde atrophy, I guess?
Well, the regeneration work that Robert Mark and others have shown definitively in the retina and now starting to show elsewhere through the system would seem to be something that you generally can expect. The interesting thing is how severe that degeneration continues down along the system, which is really relevant because quietly there's been a group working here for a long, long time. Alessandra's not here, but Alessandra Angelucci and others, and we are going to have, I've heard this before, but I'm pretty confident, the first of the Moran Cordovis array implanted in the visual cortex in humans this summer. And we're going to find out. It's a place where you can actually get very robust heavy density, you know, they already have an array that'll stimulate 625 points. The original one's gonna be 100. And this is gonna be the first time we're gonna answer. And those who have had normal vision and lost their eyes, the ones they're looking for that they've wound up are people who then had trauma and lost all vision, but have had a fully formed system, but they've lost their vision with a period of a few years. Is that a time where you could, don't have enough, you know, so much atrophy in the cortex to get usable vision? Theoretically, you could get excellent vision. You get better vision there than you can certainly in the retina and the optic nerve. The optic nerve is so tight that you're getting crossover signals. You've got room, you know, for potentially get some very usable vision. And so we're going to start answering, you know, that question about what's left of the circumstances. But if you give it enough time, obviously this rewiring is important and can be if there is microvascular disease, that is beyond just what's happening, you know, in the optic nerve head and scattered through there, then I think we would have seen more obvious signs of it in regards to elsewhere. I mean, I don't imagine anything could just be the visual system and not the rest of the brain, and that just has not popped up as a clinical entity. So I think that that's unlikely. That's, you know, we'll know, but I just think it's unlikely that we would not have picked up on that in some other clinical signs in regards to all the glaucoma patients we've been treating.
Thank you. And then the last question, MR imaging playing a role in glaucoma research versus patient care. I think it's pretty clear that it's not a useful measure for monitoring patients. I mean, that one study suggests if someone has opaque optic media, but in research it could be something interesting down the road. I want to thank Dr. DeGree for helping with this presentation, and thank you.